Welcome to From Newcastle, a podcast featuring the latest developments in health, science and culture and the creative arts from Newcastle University. In this series, From Newcastle for Engagement, we'll hear about how our teaching and research is shared, enriched and enhanced through partnerships and collaborations working beyond the university. Discover the different ways in which our work is having a positive impact, improving the economy, health, social well-being, and cultural richness of the places in which we operate. Hi, I'm Izzy, and you're listening to From Newcastle. Today, I'll be talking to Dr. Rob Collins, Senior Lecturer in Archaeology at Newcastle University and Project Manager to the Hadrian's Wall Community Archaeology Project, and Mike Collins, Senior World Heritage Advisor at Historic England about the UNESCO World Heritage Site, Hadrian's Wall. Hadrian's Wall was the northwest frontier of the Roman Empire for nearly 300 years and crossed northern Britain from Wall's End on the River Tyne in the east to Bowness on Solway in the west. In this episode, we'll learn how partnerships are playing a key role in the future of Hadrian's Wall, the importance of community engagement, and how you can get involved in the Hadrian's Wall 1900 Festival, celebrating the 1900th anniversary of the beginning of the construction of the wall. Welcome, Rob and Mike. Okay, so to kick off, please can you both introduce yourself and give a short overview of your work?
My name is Mike Collins, and I work for Historic England. My background is I come from an archaeological point of view. I graduated in archaeology at the University of York, and I've spent the last 25 years either involved in archaeological excavation or heritage management, largely on Hadrian's Wall for the last 20 years. So my job, as I say, I work for Historic England. I used to be an inspector, what's called an inspector of ancient monuments, which is a job title that goes back to 1882, unchanged. The job has changed a little bit in that time, but effectively it's been advising central and local government and owners and occupiers of Hadrian's Wall on its management and future development. I think some people would think that heritage management is about, you know, simply protecting stuff, and it is about that, but it actually the job is more about positive management of change. So I think that's something that perhaps, you know, would be surprising that an archaeologist would talk about that. It's about the positive management of change in the historic environment.
I'm Dr. Rob Collins. So I'm a senior lecturer in archaeology here at Newcastle University, but I'm also the project manager of the National Lottery Heritage Funded Project that we call WALCAP for short. It's a Hadrian's Wall Community Archaeology Project. And so part of the project is actually undertaking research that allows for better conservation and management of Hadrian's Wall, which fits into Mike's job, actually, in terms of that management for the future.
Great. And can you tell us a bit about your background and what got you into this area of work? I'm really interested to see how Hadrian's Wall sort of came into both of your lives.
By accident. I'm a Romanist entirely by accident, really. My university education was, you know, you learn an awful lot about what happened in a single decade early in the 7th century was essentially my background. And by a process of elimination, I ended up excavating on sites of a whole variety of periods, and then working in development advice archaeology for Northumberland County Council. When my knees started to give out, that seemed to be a sensible sort of step to take. And Hadrian's Wall was obviously within the county of Northumberland, and that came up quite a lot. And then when a vacancy came to be able to, I suppose, specialise not so much in the Roman period, but a single monument and its wider management, not just sort of, you know, planning advice and those kind of things, but its wider management and engagement with the public and all of those things that go alongside a UNESCO World Heritage Site. That seemed like too good an opportunity to miss to do something a bit sort of wider. So yes, I think dyed-in-the-wool Romanist would probably still see me as being, you know, something other. But at the same time, I've had it for 20 years and I haven't lived my life through it like some people have, but I have tried to serve it as well as I can do. So that's my sort of background.
Oh, lovely. And Rob as well?
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure you can't tell from my accent because I sound just like a local. But I came over to England from America to do my postgrad degree, initially a master's. And actually, I also was in York at the University of York, and I was doing their master's in medieval archaeology. And when it came time to pick a dissertation topic, I was really interested in the 5th century. I really liked that kind of end of Roman Britain, the start of early medieval Britain period, that age of Arthur. And so I was talking with my supervisor and saying, oh, you know, I'm not sure what to look at. What part of Britain should I look at? And he said, well, why don't you look at Hadrian's Wall? There's been some interesting archaeology there recently. And I started researching it for my master's, and I just, you know, Mike is going to mock me in a moment, but I kind of fell in love with the wall. That was kind of my light bulb moment in terms of, yes, this is what I want to do with the rest of my life. I want to study a giant wall. And so that led me to kind of continue on and do a PhD and looking very much at kind of the end of the Roman army on Hadrian's Wall and what does that mean. And I've been fortunate enough to be able to get a job and you know, be a postdoc and eventually land a permanent position where I can continue to study Hadrian's Wall and research Hadrian's Wall. So I kind of never expected to fall in love with a giant monument, but I did. And so, as Mike has alluded to, some of us maybe do live a little bit vicariously through a big stone wall. But
and there's nothing inherently wrong in that. It's, you know, the energy and enthusiasm that comes through from the, I suppose, the Romanist, the wall archaeological community is, you know, it's really heartening to see. You sometimes tend to work, I don't know, if you're working particularly through the pandemic, a little bit in isolation, and that knowledge that out there there is an audience, you know, a friendly audience, sometimes a critical friend, and rightly so, that is holding you to account in terms of management, but also really sort of wedded to and enthusiastic about that archaeology, and gives, you know, a reason why one of the real reasons why we're so concerned with its management is absolutely great. It's a big monument, and it can take a whole variety of sort of different approaches, and there's place for you know, the most casual visitor, its role in, you know, I'm sure we're going to come on to, you know, its role in the economy and arts and heritage and culture that it can play, as well as the, you know, the Roman archaeological side of things. Really important though that is.
And Rob, what is the Hadrian's Wall Community Archaeology Project, and sort of what does it aim to achieve?
Yeah, it's fantastic. Community archaeology has been something that's been growing in the UK for at least 20 years and maybe even going back 30 years. The British public, I think, is perhaps one of the best informed publics about its archaeology and history around the world. And that's because there's this fantastic tradition in British television of, you know, not just, you know, going back to like Time Team, but also was it Animal, Mineral, Vegetable? I think ran through the 60s, which featured
Animal, Vegetable, Mineral.
Oh, I'm sorry, the wrong order. But that featured a very prominent archaeologist of the time. So I think popular culture in Britain has often had a place for archaeology, and so actually the British public is really well informed about its history in many ways, and people want to be involved. You know, archaeology is fun. It's kind of mysterious and exciting. You know, you can look at Indiana Jones and Lara Croft, or I mean, the new Far Cry movie that's coming out with Tom Holland, that there's a real appetite for that sense of discovery, and people want to do it. And actually, Hadrian's Wall is a huge monument. There's lots of opportunities there. And so all we did was really, we conceived of a project that we knew we could involve members of the public who want to be involved with Hadrian's Wall. We have kind of survey data that tells us that. And this is something that, you know, while we were formulating the project, I was speaking with Mike about in terms of his capacity of, well, people want to do archaeology, they want to excavate, but we also need to make sure that we're safeguarding and protecting the wall and make sure it's there for future generations. And so Mike was very good about pointing out the heritage at risk agenda, which is a big part of his job. And working together, we were able to formulate a project where we could do field work and people could participate in the archaeology of Hadrian's Wall. But not only were we doing field work and kind of doing the cool research bits, the end part of that was making sure the wall was left in a better state of repair or conservation, or where we weren't repairing or conserving, that actually the information we could give back to Mike allowed him to do his job better. And so there, I'd like to say it is community-based. We want everyone involved, but part of that is helping all communities to understand, you know, archaeology isn't just about digging, which is fun. It's actually thinking about, you know, how we do protect it and ensure it's there for future generations to enjoy.
And sort of what methods do you use when researching and excavating?
There's a whole bunch of methods there. So one of the first things really that we have to do is in the business, what we call a DBA, a desk-based assessment. We're basically doing a library search. What do we already know about that site? Because part of that process of doing fieldwork is we then need to submit an application especially if it's an area or a site which is protected, we need to submit an application to get permission to legally investigate that site. So even if it's not invasive or intrusive, so geophysical survey, where you know you take instruments and you're measuring the difference of electrical signals as they arc through the ground or magnetic signals, that requires what's known as a Section 42 license. So that doesn't damage or hurt anything, but it is an official investigation that requires official approval, which means we have to write a project methodology. We have to submit, you know, the application to do that. There's an even longer application, a more detailed project methodology to excavate. So we're always kind of starting with, what do we know about the site? Is there a key problem or is there a key research interest that we have? And so once we do that kind of background research, there's a dialogue there, for example, between myself and Mike saying, you know, I'm not sure if this method will work, or actually, you know, you focused on this, but there's another issue over here. Do you want to include that? And so there's a dialogue there in terms of how do we best do this work to everyone's benefit? And once that's agreed upon, and once permissions are in place, we then start undertaking that work. And so we will often do geophysical work, geophysical survey, where possible. That allows us, without having to destroy anything in the ground through excavation, it allows us often to be able to identify where there's areas of interest, because it's very time consuming and really expensive to open up a very large trench. So often we're using smaller trench sizes, so a more focused investigation. And geophysics helps us to identify those focused locations. You know, the digging itself is great, but we have to keep a whole load of paperwork while we're excavating. We take hundreds, if not thousands, of photographs. You know, we're taking all sorts of measurements using kind of digital survey equipment, total stations, theodolites, handheld GPS positions, that sort of thing, as well as kind of, you know, our old-fashioned pencil and paper, you know, to draw those trenches. So there's a whole bunch of work that goes into just getting to dig. There's a whole bunch of work that goes into the excavation. And then there's probably the most work actually is once the excavation is done and you have to turn all those notes and photographs and drawings into a report that interprets what you've done and makes that report available, because archaeology, fieldwork, excavation is a destructive process. So if you don't produce that report, then you've destroyed archaeology and no one knows what you found in the process. So being really responsible and thorough and talking to someone who might be a specialist in understanding ancient soils, what does that chunk of soil you've kept a sample of, what does that mean if that person looks at it? What does it mean for another specialist when they look at the pottery you found, for example? What can they tell you about the pottery? And it's bringing all those different bits and pieces together to create an interpretation and a narrative of that site so that others can read that report and understand the value of the site and how that's contributed to our knowledge.
And I think you've mentioned before in the past, Rob, that you are particularly interested in the smaller finds. So do you think these can reveal more about a culture than sort of the bigger finds that seem more exciting and interesting?
There's a balance. I mean, to be honest, it's really exciting when you find a big building. I think, you know, that's very cool. But there's also something a bit intimate about a small find, about an object, because it's something that, you know, another person has used. Buildings can sometimes seem a bit abstract, but when you get, you know, a stylus, you know, an ancient writing implement, or a glass that, you know, someone has drunk wine out of or something, it just brings with it a bit of connection to the humanity of the past.
What kind of challenges have you both encountered when capturing information about the wall?
I think scale is an issue. It's a big site. It's a really big site. And the other thing about it is it's almost all in private ownership. The parts that are presented to the public by, you know, my colleagues at English Heritage, Vindolanda Trust, National Trust, is actually only a relatively small fragment of the wall as well. The vast majority is in private ownership, predominantly agricultural, but it also goes to the middle of Carlisle, to the middle of Newcastle and North Tyneside and South Tyneside. So, you know, the urban areas have their own sort of challenges. So the scale and then sort of trying to understand condition over that kind of area, you know, it's privileged to be able to specialize in one particular monument, but at the same time, that does mean that there is only one person. And so you're reliant on an awful lot of joining the dots of the bits that you see, but also an awful lot on the wall community in its widest sense out there reporting things that they notice that may or may not be a particular issue. So whether it's the owners who have plans, you know, over the next 20 years to clean their agricultural ditches out that happen to cross the monument, or people who have individual houses and they may want to extend them, and they'll approach you in good time and have those kind of discussions. You're so reliant on those kind of conversations. And then back to that thing of the sort of partnerships and personal relationships that you manage to build up with individuals. That's half the battle for the opportunity that helps you overcome the difficulties. But essentially, what we have to do is to join the dots of places that you haven't either seen for a long time or that you've seen regularly, but then you haven't seen the bits in between. The level of private ownership is always a challenge. 500 plus owners or occupiers of bits of Hadrian's Wall, as well as the statutory undertakers, your roads and utilities and those kind of things. If we're talking about positive management of change, it's a living, working landscape, not an archaeological theme park in the majority. So that bargain, that pact, means that we have to be there to listen to what other people want, as well as what I would want as a heritage manager, and try our best to accommodate the needs and the challenges that modern society has. So, you know, the bit, particularly the urban bits, the electricity or gas network that runs through and around the wall. When, you know, we're not going to maintain, and rightly so, the political support and wider public support, if we start saying no, we need to you know, wipe that stuff back, and no, you can't have a reliable electricity supply through that bit of the wall because the wall's too important. Our job is to make it possible, to make sure the significance of the wall can be managed and can be protected, but that it can continue to serve its purpose to the wider community in the present day.
And you sort of mentioned there a bit, Mike, about the partnerships. So what have you learned from how the partnerships work? Is it something that's quite a positive thing, or is it something that brings a lot of issues?
I mean, it always does have issues because it's giving up control or giving up personal oversight of something. And the temptation is always that, you know, you'd like to see it yourself or control it at a higher level. You know, with goodwill and partnership, that's not strictly necessary. You know, there are archaeologists out there doing field work who know far more about the excavation techniques. It's a while since I've done it. And you have to trust that sort of pedigree and that track record. So, you know, Rob's team, also Ian Haynes at the university, our own Tony Wilmot, the Vindolanda Trust, and Tanner Weir Archives and Museums, just to, you know, to name but a few. Apologies for anyone listening whose project I haven't mentioned. Because there are a lot of good people out there doing that kind of work. So it's that trust that you know that these people are going to deliver on what they say they're going to do. They are careful and methodical. They're conscious of their responsibilities to the public and responsibilities to the heritage. So once you realize that and you've developed that those sort of partnerships and good relationships, which is half the battle, you're obviously in a much better place for letting those things go forward, giving up control, and, you know, good things tend to happen.
And Rob, as well, why do you think it is important for universities and researchers like yourself to work with other organisations and local communities on these sorts of projects?
Yeah, I think there's always this real danger that universities are seen as an ivory tower, that we're closed off from the rest of the world. And that in some cases, that almost sounds like a lovely dream at one level, but it's also very dangerous. And universities aren't closed off places. We connect to the wider world. Our integral to our job is being able to provide, you know, detailed skills and learning to the next generation of workers, as it were, in society. And to make sure that we have an offering across all subjects so that we have, you know, excellent economists and excellent engineers, but also excellent artists and excellent archaeologists. So when you have a subject like archaeology, which is really popular and actually is often undertaken because of public support, you know, archaeology is one of those subjects where there's very clear public support and engagement and interest. It's incumbent upon us to make sure that we involve the public and communicate those results back to the public. We don't exist in that ivory tower. And what's really important is that everyone can enjoy heritage. So, you know, I'm very fortunate that I was able to, you know, to go off and do a PhD and study something I love. And actually, one of the things that's made me love and respect kind of the tradition of Hadrian's Wall studies in archaeology is that, you know, for over 150 years, there's been this tradition of, if you are a wall scholar, part of your job is to take that research back to to the people in the community. And so that's great. There's this kind of sense of responsibility that we're not just talking amongst a small group of scholars, that actually we're talking to a whole bunch of different audiences. And, you know, the reality of the modern day, that it's great that we have people like Mike in Historic England, whose job it is to safeguard our heritage, you know, so that we can continue to enjoy it. You know, you can look in countries across the world that don't have those safeguards and protections, and their heritage is being destroyed. So it's really important that as an academic in a university that I work with people like Mike, who work in stakeholder organizations whose job is guardianship or management, but also that, you know, I communicate and talk to the public and make sure I know what they're interested in, because if they don't value our heritage, then my entire subject is kaput in that sense.
And something else I'm quite interested in is, how has your work changed during the pandemic? Have any positives come from it? Because I know, having been locked in the house for years and years, it seems like we've all come out and sort of had this real pride for the UK and the landscape and the heritage we have.
For us on WallCap, actually, we had a bit of a challenge because it was a public participation project. And a lot of that participation was fieldwork based, you know, being outside, being present in person. When we went into lockdown, there was we couldn't do that anymore. Where we were fortunate is we'd always had built into our project some digital outreach and engagement and some digital work. But so what we were able to do was kind of pivot entirely to a digital offering during lockdown. That meant we couldn't do the field work. So that was really hard for us as a project. But actually what we could do is we're able to take that time and really skill up our volunteers. We spent a lot of time, I guess, in what you might call them, you know, quote, knowledge delivery, as it were, but we were able to talk about fieldwork techniques and when certain techniques were appropriate and when they weren't. We were able to use online resources like historic environments LIDAR data, and we could send our volunteers to those websites and say, okay, here's the LIDAR for Housesteads. You know, what can you see? What pops out? And we were able to talk through all sorts of things like that. We started a Hadrian's Wall book club and a Hadrian's Wall film club. We even just did a volunteer tea break to make sure that people were touching base and talking to each other, because a number of our volunteers were OAPs who lived by themselves. And our project was a way that they were mixing and socializing. So we wanted to make sure that we were able to continue to offer that. And what's been great is actually, I think one of the silver linings of COVID has actually been to really have a much better understanding of how archaeology and heritage contributes to a sense of well-being. Because our volunteers have been really clear about that in many cases, that if it weren't for our project and just having that monthly tea break, or looking forward to, you know, when we could arrange a speaker from, say, Germany or the Netherlands or from Israel to talk about their frontiers, you know, how much enjoyment they got out of that. There's been challenges with COVID, but actually it's also, I think, been really good to highlight what we do on a daily basis is really important.
And Mike, as well, how has your work changed during the pandemic?
It's been challenging because a lot of my work is, I'd call it loosely, casework. You know, you're going to go and look at a particular issue, a particular site to do with, whether it's a development proposal or a management issue. And if you can't physically get out and look at it, it's, you know, it's a real challenge. That there's that thing of, well, I did once see it 8 or 9 years ago, kind of thing. How much can you do from Google Earth? All of those kind of, you know, how to work smarter kind of things have been tried and worked to a greater and lesser extent. So I think there's been real challenges there, but the really positive side of things has been the virtual meeting. Traditionally, if I'd had to go you know, somewhere a couple of hours drive, by the time you've had a meeting and come back, that's the whole day gone. You don't necessarily have to do that every time. You can see people, you know, virtually face to face in an environment and get those things done at relatively short notice and much less cost in terms of time, where you can loosely get away with it. And I think that has been a real positive for things like the Hadrian's Wall virtual conference. So yearly get together. Traditionally, we've done that face to face, but the last couple of years we've been doing that virtually, hosted again, very happy to say, by our colleagues at Newcastle University this year, 26th of February to the 3rd of March. Yes, Rob, I did just go and check to make sure the dates were right. So that's a general conference for people who live, work, and are interested in Hadrian's Wall and its management and what's going on. So that sort of chance to understand the kind of things that are taking place, not just the research, but the opportunities that are currently out there with economic development, money, and all of those kind of issues, a chance to hear a bit more about what's going on. And again, people might not necessarily been able to devote themselves to an entire day or 2 days over a weekend to go and make those contacts and understand those things. Now they can dip in and out of individual talks, see the program. And we've ended up with a wider participation. Yes, it has some of the disadvantages of not being able to see each other face to face, but at the same time, that wider participation, I think it's been slightly surprising and a little bit shocking just how much of an appetite there is out there for this kind of public participation. And that's a brilliant thing. I like being shocked in a way that suggests that far more people want to be involved.
And then what opportunities are there for people to engage with Hadrian's Wall? As you mentioned, it seems like the older generation are particularly interested. Are there young people engaging with it as well?
There really are. I think one of the things that it's fair to talk about are what are the barriers to participation? And so, you know, traditionally, you know, an older generation is seen as, oh, they're the typical volunteer, but it's also because they're often the demographic that has more time on their hands. And so one of those barriers to participation is, well, when do these activities occur? Is it possible for, you know, adults with childcare responsibilities, can they get involved? If so, well, when? Or, you know, young adults, how can they get involved? Because they might be still in school, or, you know, they're also locked into a work schedule. So I think one of the things is just that diversity of offer and knowing what there is out there. So you can look at programs, for example, like the Nalanda Trust, who have an annual excavation program, and you can register and sign on as a volunteer to take a two-week excavation slot. So if you can bunch all your, you know, your annual leave together and participate, that's great. We've tried to focus in WallCap on providing opportunities for kind of different age groups, but more catered toward local communities and give people something they can focus on locally. So it reduces any kind of need for transport, and also schedule those events at different times. So sometimes it's a weekday evening, sometimes it's weekends, sometimes it's during the weekday, and just trying to be variable about that. And what's really great is there's a number of organizations along Hadrian's Wall. So we've already mentioned the Nalanda Trust, but you have English Heritage and they take volunteers. You've got the National Trust and they take volunteers. You've got Tyne and Wear Museums, Archives and Museums, they take volunteers. And Northumberland National Park takes volunteers, as well as Tully House in Carlisle and the Zen House Trust in Maryport. All those organizations are really happy to accept volunteers and harness that passion and enthusiasm. There's also, as Mike mentioned, kind of the virtual networking day. So, you know, if you are a local, part of a local community, and you want to find out what's happening, you don't have to necessarily do any work. You just need to kind of pop into a Zoom and kind of listen. And that might also present more opportunities. The challenge actually isn't why can't I get involved so much as what do I choose to get involved with? Because actually, once you start looking, there's a ton of opportunities. And we're really fortunate. Hadrian's Wall, I think, provides a bit of a focus for that in ways that other parts of Britain don't benefit from. You know, the very scale of the monument means that all those opportunities are spread out along its length. They're not just focused, you know, in Newcastle, for example. And in that sense, I think we're really quite fortunate. Wouldn't you say, Mike?
I would. I agree with all you've said there, Rob. I think where we've tended to focus our thinking is trying to think of where the gaps are. And I think the young people participation, the barriers to that, both sort of financial and opportunity-wise, really thinking about what we might do to start to tackle those. So we have a partnership, and we do ones. I'm really sorry to tell you this, Rob, but we do have partnerships outside the ones we do with Newcastle University. I know it's...
I'm weeping in jealousy and in betrayal.
Horrifying for you. We have a partnership with the Vindolanda Trust to offer bursaries to young people 16 through 19 to cover their costs for taking part a two-week placement within the world-famous Vindolanda excavations. And this year, there are 10 places. Next year, 10 places. This year, we're focusing on the Tyne Valley, which I suppose has a sort of superficial reputation as being, you know, a very, very beautiful place, undoubtedly. But it also is a place where we've struggled to get local participation sometimes. And there are communities which we found hard to reach. Next year, targeting Tyne Valley again, but also looking for a partner perhaps in, you know, Carlisle or the west end of Newcastle or South Shields or North Tyneside, where there are, you know, more barriers to young people's participation. That chance to, you know, not commit yourself full time to, you know, an undergraduate degree necessarily at this stage, but to dip your toe in the water. Is this something that you'd like to do? It's a real challenge with some communities to think that option might not, you know, be available. So the idea of covering their costs, but also transport costs, food costs, accommodation costs to allow those young people to participate And I think the other thing that we've realized we need to do more of is that sort of wider and broadening participation. So that Hadrian's Wall, said before, you know, it's a big monument with a lot of different kind of communities along it. And it doesn't have to be just about the sort of pure archaeological discovery side of things. It can be a spur socially and economically through art, theatre, food, all of those kind of things to understand what communities value about the wall and the heritage in their area, and use the wall as an opportunity to do more, and not just not to be too fixated about the wall just being about Roman archaeology, but it being about sort of so much more, and about enriching lives that happen to be in its vicinity as well. This is something we're only just beginning to scratch the surface of, but we're really, really keen on. I know Newcastle University are likewise. So I do have to mention the Hadrian's Wall 1900 Festival at this point, which has so many opportunities for participation, both learning ones, but also grassroots community-based events coming up from the communities along the wall. So it's a year-long festival in 2022. It's 1900 years since the notional start of the construction of Hadrian's Wall. Rob and I will almost certainly not be around for the 2000th anniversary. So we're going to make the best of this one as much as we possibly can. We've already got 130 plus events and community groups who want to be a part of this festival. There's loads of opportunity there for people to be involved, or say, actually, we're already thinking about this. Would that come under the umbrella of Hadrian 1900? Could we attract a wider audience to it? Almost certainly, yes. So get in touch.
And sort of talking about the festival, what are your hopes for the future of Hadrian's Wall?
Personally, I think it's an absolutely massive opportunity, that chance for the wall to fulfill its, I can say, sounding all pompous, fulfill its destiny, fulfill its potential, economically, socially, and culturally. It has that massive opportunity. It's always been really important. Everybody has always been proud of it, but it can deliver so much more without compromise to the effective management and the protection of its remains. And I think people want that both locally and all the way up to central government. There's the Borderlands growth deal that government has announced earmarks a lot of money for levelling up related activity in the border of England and Scotland. And there's a specific, very considerable pot of money for Hadrian's Wall related things. And I think that's a massive vote of confidence that government sees that groundswell of support from local people and the ability of organisations along the wall, including ourselves, to deliver societal change and make the wall fulfill its potential. So I'm really ambitious for it. And I think it's going to be absolutely brilliant. It's had a great start already, but I think it's going to be a really exciting year.
And Rob, what would you say are your hopes for the future? Would you agree with that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Hadrian's Wall has so much potential. It's we already know so much of its potential. It's got global recognition. How many archaeological monuments have global recognition? It's, George R. R. Martin, the author of Game of Thrones, is on the record saying, that was the earliest part of his inspiration for Game of Thrones, his giant ice wall, after a visit kind of to the Housesteads area in 1981. So Hadrian's Wall is, while it might be a monument of imperialism in the past, actually in the present, it's very much a force for cultural good, that it gives local communities a focus. Many of those communities are not only metaphorically built from Hadrian's Wall, but actually quite literally built from Hadrian's Wall, as the farmhouses and the castles and the churches have been built reusing the stone taken from the Roman monument. So there's all sorts of local connections across the centuries, but it's not just local communities. It's the fact that it is designated World Heritage. There are people who travel here from all around the world to see it. There's an initiative at the moment, delegates from the UK and delegates from China who are talking about the Great Wall of China and Hadrian's Wall together and trying to understand the different challenges that each monument faces and what lessons we can learn from each other in a very positive way. The fact that our wall is a springboard for international conversation with UNESCO, with other countries, that it draws tourists internationally, as well as being a source of local pride, is just absolutely fantastic. You couldn't really ask for anything more. So, I think the job of Mike and I and our other colleagues is just to help the wall realize that potential.
Oh, absolutely. And Finally, a question for Mike that we like to ask all of our partners is, what do you like about working with Newcastle University?
I can only speak from my own experience. I think it's that recognition of its important place in local society. It's obviously chock-a-block with extremely well-qualified and eminent academic staff doing amazing research and educational things. That goes without saying, but it's also seeing its role within the Northeast and the wider community that's been, I think, a really massive positive thing. So certainly over the last decade plus, the fact that the University Archaeology Department has been really, really interested in the research potential on its doorstep. We did go through a period which I think, you know, in some ways was unfortunate, whereby there was a popular held methodological opinion that we really only had to dot the I's and cross the T's on understanding Hadrian's Wall, and then it was done. We really understood what it was there for, and who needs to focus research on that kind of thing. And it's very far from the truth. And the fact that Newcastle University, people like, you know, Rob's team, Ian Haynes, Jane Webster, have done terrific work. Kevin Green, sorry, I'm going to end up missing out somebody really, really important. I realized I was almost going to miss out Kevin, whose book was the first book on archaeology that I ever read. So I don't think that's a good idea to have missed Kevin out. Doing amazing research local to it and recognizing its wider, not just responsibilities, that because that implies you have to drag somebody in to do it, but their enthusiasm for research on their doorstep. I don't work in the public relations department of Newcastle University even part-time, but that idea of wider responsibility, what is the university there for, and taking that really, really seriously. It's not just for them window dressing to their wider academic priorities. It's at the core of what they do, certainly in terms of my experience of working with the university. So that's been very good. And, you know, I have to say, you know, for the purposes of balance, they're not the only local university who are active on the wall and who do, you know, do really good work. But yeah, your question is about what do we like about working with the university? It's that commitment to its local and its wider responsibilities that really gets my energy.
Oh, well, thank you so much, Mike and Rob. This has been such an interesting discussion and talk about the importance of Hadrian's Wall and its sort of cultural significance here in the Northeast. Thank you so much for coming along.
No problem. Thanks, Izzy. It's been a pleasure.
If you'd like to find out more about WallCap and get involved in the Hadrian's Wall 1900 Festival, visit podcast.ncl.ac.uk/from Newcastle. Next time, we'll be joined by Jane Robinson, Pro Vice Chancellor of Engagement and Place at Newcastle University, and Arielle Armony, Vice Provost for Global Affairs at the University of Pittsburgh, to learn about the close links between the two institutions. Thank you for listening to this episode of From Newcastle. If you enjoyed it, then please click the subscribe button. We love to hear your comments or suggestions, so please get in touch at fromnewcastlepodcast@ncl.ac.uk or via social media at fromnclpodcast.